Good afternoon, everyone. Those who have joined this session, I welcome you all here. I am just seeing some of my students and scholars are joining up. Abhilasa Prakash is there. Anjali Singh, Abhilasa Singh also. And Somu Singh is also live now. I give my regards to Dr. Rajni Ranjan Singh also. And I think many of the teachers are now joining, some of the students also, they are joining. So, good afternoon, everyone. First of all, let me give my regards to all the senior teachers, those who have joined this session. And then I will also like to thank Dr. Somu Singh, who has taken up this initiative to organize this series of live lectures on very serious topics, very important topics during this time of lockdown. It has been a very nice learning experience to all of us. So I am very much thankful to Dr. Somu Singh from BHU, and he has given me the opportunity to share my knowledge with you. That is also I am appreciating, and I hope my session with you will be fruitful, and you will be learning something which will which you can use it in the future, and you can in the time essential, whatever time essential the requirements are there, that we are now facing the pandemic situation, and whatever the future is there in the store, this particular session on ICT in education, time essential and the future perspective, whatever I am going to share, I think in some way it is going to benefit all the researcher, all the teachers community, and all the students. So if I will go on citing different technology and different digital platforms which are available nowadays, there are hundreds of platforms available online, and there are plenty of opportunity, plenty of website, plenty of apps, and numerous applications are there which can be used for educational purpose. But the time what has been given to us for 60 minutes I have to speak, I cannot take up all those applications and discuss all of them to you. So what I can do is that I have just tried to take up a few of the important application which will be useful for all the teachers, all the researchers, all the students, prospective teachers, that will be useful to them while they are going to interact with the students, while they are going to share the resources with the students, and while they are going to do certain educational work during this particular time and in the future also. So, and this is the requirement of the time also. If I will, I have just taken up certain quotes which I will like to share with you. Some of the essential educationists, eminent educationists, they have talked about that how this technology has become the important aspect of our life now. This pandemic situation you could not have handled if this technology would have not been there. So this technology had been a very much important role to play to save us, to make us survive this particular situation, and then in the future also. So a few of the educationists, as I quote Dr. Marcus Speck, professor of advanced Open University of Netherlands, what he says: the students of the future will demand the learning support that is appropriate for their situation or context, nothing more, nothing less. And they want it at the moment the need arises, not sooner nor later. Mobile devices will be a key technology to providing that learning support. So what I can follow from this particular quote that the student now, those are there, they want whatever knowledge they require, they want that knowledge should be supplied to them at that particular immediate time only, they should get that knowledge. And also in their context also, in whatever context they are asking, in that context also they should get the knowledge. And then they cannot wait, they don't have the patience also that they can wait and wait for the next class and get the knowledge. So technology can be one of the help which will help you so that you can provide them the knowledge and you can handle those students of 21st generation, which are also called as digital natives. So this is one of the aspect which I like to share. Some other aspects are there, which as stated by Keith Beckman, that I'm not going to read that quote or whatever he has said, but what I can get out from his saying that, he said that technology can make us that for a teacher that they can become more and more interactive with the students, and they can also encourage the students to collaborate in the work. The collaborative platform also it can create, so collaboration possibilities are also there in more and more number. So technology can help in that regard also. So that also I will like to discuss some of the technology which I will like to discuss. So they will try to give you certain ideas, certain hints where you can use technology to improve your skill, to improve, to satisfy the learners of 21st century. So that I am trying to discuss today. So basically what I have done that I have tried to categorize that whatever technology is available nowadays, I have tried to categorize them into certain particular areas which will overall, I'm going in the mixed way so that whatever, because there were several applications available. So what I did that, I just tried to get certain applications which will be suitable for you for different areas. So one of the category which I have made that where you can organize your resources and where you can organize whatever knowledge you have got, whatever content material you have got, whatever documents you have got, whatever videos you have got, whatever learning resources you have got, you can organize it at a particular place and then you can share with the students. So that is one category that we can say it as a multimedia organizing and sharing platforms. So that is one of the technological category which I have tried to make it, that multimedia sharing and organizing applications. So in this category, if you see, in this category, you will find that the first one, first of all, which comes under this particular category is very popular. Google Sites are there. You must be knowing Google Sites. And one of the particular application which is very much popular, which has influenced me also while experiencing it, while using it, that is Wakalit. If you will try to write it down, it is spelled as Wakalet. Wakalet. Wakalet is one of the platform which has influenced me a lot. So it is also open also. You can organize whatever. Suppose you want to share the resources with the students. Suppose you want to give maximum learning output to the students. Then what you can do, suppose you are a science teacher and you want to prepare one presentation or a talk or a particular area of the study, suppose in a particular topic, suppose acid, base and salt. So what you can do on Wakalet, you can create your account, and in that account you can put the videos, the audios, the documents, the text file, whatever essential things are there, you can put it there. And then later on, it actually, it is very much dynamic also, very much presentable also. You must experience it. You, after this particular session, you try to make one account in that particular application on available website in the website also, and it is also available in the mobile app. So you can go and download it in mobile also. That particular application is there, and you can also make an account on using your desktop also. So how to, just I will try to brief, I will give you certain idea, just in certain summary of this particular platform, which will be useful for you. This will make your task very much effective and very much useful for your students also. So what you can do, you can go to the website of Wakelet. You can sign up there, giving your credentials. And then what you can do is you can create your account. And the first thing which you can do is there that you start thinking of the topics on which you want to work, or on which you have got, suppose you are teacher of research methodology. So on research methodology, suppose you want to share the resources with your students, then what you can do is that you go to that particular page, that particular account, and then you start exploring the different options available throughout the website. Certain ebooks are available, certain videos are available on YouTube related to research methodology, certain podcasts are available on the website. So wherever you get the materials, what you can do, you can create bookmarks in that particular Wakelet page. I hope you know bookmarks. You can create one link there, and it will be also presentable form also. You can tag it, you can name it, you can give one thumbnail also, so that it will be suppose at last you have to share it with your students. So once your students will see that particular bookmarks, they will able to know that what this particular bookmark is all about. So they should know that this particular video which has been tagged here, it is basically about action research, and this particular action research video is being given by a particular person. So that type of knowledge you can create there. So you can do social bookmarking there. You can nicely arrange the things there and bookmark it. Then you can also organize whatever your personal resources are there. Suppose you have prepared some PowerPoint presentation, certain videos of your own, certain video lectures are available with you. So what you can do is that also you can organize there. That also you can present there. You can save it there. And then you can, suppose the possibilities may be also there that you want to, as a teacher, you want to share your work with other teachers, your colleagues, and you want to develop on that particular Wakelet page. Then what you can do is that you can share that page also with your colleagues or with your friends. So if they will found something related to your particular work, they can also add to that particular page. They can also make it more productive and more quality one. So these things can also be added to that particular thing. Now one, two more things I would like to share about this one, this particular app, Wakelet. It has got the embedding facility also. What it means that if you have got, suppose you must be using blogs, you must be using forums. So what you can do, you can use that embedding link is also there. You can take that embedding link from here. You can directly, whatever look is there of your Wakelet page, you can directly paste it, or you can directly export it to your blog. So if you don't want to share, or if someone is not going to visit your Wakelet page, then what they can visit your blog, and there also they can see the resources. So that embedding facility is also there. So that can be also done. You can also, suppose if in the nowadays, suppose students are not having internet facility, the students are not, in each and every student may not be having that particular facility with them, then what you can do, you can share your resource by downloading it in PDF form. That facility is also available. Whatever page you have created, whatever informations are there, what you can do is that you just export that particular page, and you just go and save it as a PDF, and that PDF printout also can be given to the students for they can use it in their future and in their for their learning work. So these type of things are also there, and it is one type of exploration only. You can also use a particular, you can directly import materials from your Google Drive, from your OneDrive. So I have seen very nice vacillate prepared on the websites, and they are very much dynamic. School teachers are using, college teachers are also using that one. So I have also prepared certain vacillate pages. So these are, and this is free of cost also. You can prepare it and you can use it, and the visibility is also much more. You can share the pages on different platforms. You can share it on Facebook, you can share it on WhatsApp, you can share it through blogs. So in different platforms you can share. Now this one, because I cannot go for all, I have also told about Google Sites, but I cannot go on saying same type of things, same type of category. I have make it one category for organizing your resources. So in Google Site also you can organize your resources. Suppose you want to keep all the essential files, essential documents, essential videos, that also you can prepare using Google Site. Google Site is, this may be my personal feeling, Google Site is not so much influential to me, because it has got certain restrictions. You cannot directly export different application to this particular Google Site page. So it is upon you that you can use Google Site also. One other sharing platform is there where you can go and share multimedia, which is also nowadays popular, and the students and the teachers are nowadays using. That is, I think, Flipgrid. Flipgrid has come up with tremendously nowadays, and the students, it is quite popular throughout the world. The students are using it, the teachers are also appreciating it. Flipgrid is also one type of platform where you can create videos, you can create discussion forums, and you can share materials. And one of the best feature which I have liked in Flipgrid, which has come up nowadays, that it has now incorporated augmented reality. Suppose as a teacher you have given certain assignment to the students. Okay, so the student has created one video giving his presentation. He has created one video, he is explaining the things to you, and then he can share that QR code with you. He may not upload the video, he will just share the QR code with you, and for the security concern also, scan that QR code, that particular student will be live, and you can see whatever presentation he is giving to you. So Flipgrid also you should explore. But in this particular category which I told you about Vacillate, about Google Site, about Flipgrid, one more category is, one more thing which you can include is Mahara. Mahara is one platform. Basically it is used for creating portfolio, but it can be also used, it is also open source. You can use it up to your whatever requirement we have got. We can use it to organize your resources, whatever resources are available with you, that you can organize it there also. You can you can create different folders regarding your particular subject wise. You can keep the materials there, videos there, and that also is very much popular. It may be little bit old, but the most popular nowadays, two things which I told you, first one is Vacillate and the second one is Flipgrid. So you must explore Vacillate. I think you will be exploring that one. So now I will move to the second category which I will be discussing today. First, which is also one of the important aspect which for the teachers nowadays, the problem they are facing is that the students, they cannot attend the classes, they cannot come to the college, they cannot come to the school, and we have to attend them remotely. We have to address them from remote location, from your house, from your whatever different places are there, and that connection should be there. Now also we are connected through certain digital platform. So what is necessary is that you should be thinking about certain system, certain platform which will help you in this particular regard. So the second category of technology which I have kept in my mind is learning management system. So whenever you are in a school or in a college, you are attached to a particular type of work, you are a teacher, you are dealing with the students, you are in the higher education, you are dealing with the students, so you are working with students on particular course. And to manage that course, we already know what are the traditional way, whatever the traditional system is there, that we already know. But nowadays in the digital world, what we are facing now, when we are not able to call the students and we cannot also go to the college and schools to attend them, then what you can do, that you have to create one management system which is very much easier to handle, very much easy to operate, and then also it is quite convenient also, free of cost also. So this is also one of the requirement which we should all be having nowadays, and we should be thinking about which particular platform we should use. So in this category, I will be discussing about three particular aspects which are from my experience, I'm just saying, which are quite popular nowadays. First one is Edmodo. The second one is Google Classroom. We all must be knowing that idea. And the third one is dedicated learning management system, which is called as learning management system, that is Moodle. So these three particular things that comes in this particular category is we are going to discuss. Now, if I will try to filter these particular categories, then what I can say about that Edmodo is the oldest one, then Google Classroom came, but learning management, but Moodle is one of the thing which is dedicated, it is called as learning management system. So what you can do, I can say that the Google Classroom is the most popular one, very easy to use. Suppose a teacher which has got minimum knowledge of a technology, then what he can do, he can go and start using Google Classroom, because every one nowadays are having all of you, whatever those who are attending this particular session, all must be having the Gmail account. And if you are having Gmail account, you can use very easily, you can go to create an account in Google Classroom and you can start using it. I will talk about this particular Google Classroom, then I will move to the other particular two things which I have talked. The second one is Edmodo, and then I will talk about Moodle. So Google Classroom, let me talk about. You already know, I already told in this multimedia sharing and keeping them safe at a place, I mentioned Google Sites. In this particular also learning management system, again I am saying Google Classroom. So you know that Google is one of the pioneer company in the digital world, in the age of technology. It is whatever popular technology is coming in the country, in the world, and it is quite needful also, it is also, they also are going and creating that particular app or that particular application on their platform also. So Google Classroom, it has come also for like this only. So how to use Google Classroom? So what you can do is that you can go, there are several options. If you are first in the desktop, it has got also app also, you can download on the mobile, that also you can do. And on the website, on the desktop also, you can use it. So what you can do is that if you are logging to your Google account, then you can directly search in the URL bar, you can directly search Google Classroom. Just click on the Google Classroom link. You will be going to the home page of Google Classroom, where they will ask you to create a class. So that you can do it. I have experienced it. I have got with my students. It has got immense potential to address the demand of the students. And different type of learning opportunities can be handled through this Google Classroom. So you can do that one, or you can just type on the URL bar classroom.google.com and you will go to the home page of Google Classroom. If you are not logging to your Gmail account, they will ask you to log into a Gmail account. You can create one Gmail account and then you can directly go to that particular Google Classroom. Then what you can do, they will get in the home screen, will get one option. Once the sign up is complete, you will get the option of creating the first class. Then what you can do, you can type the class name there. Suppose you are teaching MED student, then you can write MED first year student, and then you can write about the paper which you are teaching. Then you can write descriptions also about that particular class, and that classroom is created. So that in that way you can create your class. If you are teaching school student also, you can name that school name there, then class you mention, then you write description about that particular classroom, and then you create or save it. Once you save it, you cannot just only one member in that particular class. You have to add the students. So the students would be there. So what you can do, you can share that class link to the students. You can also add teachers also, because you may be teaching one paper with different other teachers, then you want to share with them, then you can invite teachers also, and you can invite the students also. So I'm using particular Google Classroom app for 4-5 years now, and it is very useful. It is, the students are very much interested also in using this particular app, particular application, because I already told you, the students which we are facing now, they are of digital world, they are digital native, they will be very much appreciating these particular platforms. So what you can do, you can share there, one command will be there of people. So you click on that people command, and then what you can do is that it, two options are there. You can send the invite through email, and other thing you can do is you will get the class code. That class code also you can share to them. So they can, you share by WhatsApp or by Facebook or by email also you can share. Then what they will do, they will also create one classroom account. They will, if they will click on the plus sign, they will get the option of join a class or create a class. Because they have to join the class, they will click on join the class. Then they can write the code there, and they will be able to join that particular class. So in that way, they will be able to join. They can also click, if you have sent through email, they can click on the email link and they can directly join to a particular class. So this, in this way, that Google Classroom, you can easily create. I tell you that if you are a novice in technology, you know minimum of technology, you can very easily click and very easily create Google Classroom. And it is very easy to use. Whatever steps I told, that minimum steps you have to follow only, not much more than that one. You just create one account, create a classroom, then just share that classroom link with the students, and they can join that particular class. Now in that Google Classroom, what things you can do? You can assign, first of all, you can share content, you share materials with them. Suppose whatever learning resources are there, you can share with them. PowerPoints, PDFs, text file, videos, all the things you can share with them. Then what else you can do? One of the important aspect is that you can give assignment. I'm just thinking about the time also, that I will be able to finish all the things which I have to discuss. But let me see. So what you can do is that you can give the assignment to them. The assignment creation option is also there. Now the assignment creation, because these all things you have to explore also, because many in technology, how much you explore, you will learn many options are available there. In basic Google, in basic Microsoft Word document also, you must not have explored each and everything. So many options are available. So what you can do in Google Classroom, when you create one assignment, then you can write that, about that particular assignment. Suppose you write, discuss what do you mean by research, or what do you mean by research problem, and you give a open-ended question to them. So in that way, you can write on that particular, when you go and give the assignment option, you have to give the name of the assignment, then you write the description what you expect from the students, that you write there, and they, what they can do, they can also write there and submit their work. That way they can do. Other way is there, you can upload. Suppose you have written the question on a piece of paper, then what you can do, you just upload that particular piece of paper on the website. Once you go to the assignment, create assignment option, you can directly attach that particular piece of paper or page where you have written the question, and directly it can be uploaded to the this particular assignment page, and the students will be able to see there. The students can also write their answer in a piece of paper, and then they can attach the answer on that assignment page, and you can get their answer. Now, things are there, other things are also there. You can communicate with them. You can give them private comments. You can also ask them that you resubmit the assignment. Suppose you are not happy with the quality of what they have done, then you can ask them to resubmit. One other option is there that you can ask them to ask them for self-evaluation also. They can do their self-evaluation and then they can submit their remarks also there. How much they judge their work, what is the output they have got about their work, that also they can keep. One of the most important thing that can be done also there, that you can also upload the rubric. Suppose a task, an assignment you have given them and you want them that they have to do this particular work with certain parameters. Okay, some parameters you have decided that these parameters should be filled, then only your assignment will be marked. So you can upload that rubric also with that one. That option is also available. And the other one thing which you can do there is that suppose you want to take a small test with the students, then what you can do is that you can create a test using Google Form. You must be knowing Google Forms. Many of the webinars you are attending nowadays, you are filling the forms using Google Forms. Then what you can do is that in that Google Form, you prepare one questions which you are going to ask them, MCQ type, and that particular Google Form also you can upload in that assignment and submit it. Then you can also fix the deadline when this assignment you want to take from them back. So that that work also you can do. You can give that time limit to the students so that Google after that date they will not be able to submit, and if they will submit also the late remark will be there. So if these particular aspects are there in Google Classroom, you can explore. They are very much nice. The second particular thing which I will discuss, because I'm seeing the time also, I have to fix to be my time duration which has been assigned to me. So Edmodo is quite similar to Google Classroom, okay, but it has also got options that you can add parents also there. You can add parents there, and the parents can also see that whatever things are going on, how the student is progressing. They will also get feedback. They will also able to comment on the work. So this Edmodo is quite similar to Google Classroom. Maximum of things, 90% of the things are quite similar. You can use Edmodo, you can use Google Classroom. Both of them are quite similar in the things, whatever they are able to perform. The other one which I wanted to discuss is Moodle. Now Moodle is basically an open source, free and open source software, which is available online. You can download it, you can install it, and then you can use it as a learning management system. Now it has got maximum benefits. If you can say that Google Classroom, Edmodo, they have developed something for us to do these particular things, but this particular Moodle is totally dedicated learning management system. It is totally for managing the classes. Suppose a courseware, you must be knowing what is courseware. Some online courses which are running online on the website, they are basically stand on courseware. To make them successful, there should be one learning management system. So learning management system should be there. So Moodle can give you that platform to create that learning management system, and you must mark that it is free of cost. Now, if I will say the data, there are around 20,000 learning communities enrolled in this particular application, and it is available in 75 languages, and it has got 160. It is being used by 160 countries. So these type of things you can see. Now, let me talk about Moodle. Something I will talk. So Moodle, in installation time, it takes, you can follow the instruction. It is available online. You just download it. It is free of cost. You just download it, install it. Installation takes certain times. It will take time, maybe to install the full package. You may require the whole day or half day. It may take. But once it is installed, it is full-fledged learning management system. You can do multiple tasks here. Suppose you are an admin, you are the head of that particular institution, you are the principal or administrator, then you can install it in your computer, you can make it install it on the web browser so that everywhere every person can access it. And what you can do is you can assign role to the teachers, you can create classes, and then you can upload the curriculum, you can upload the timetable, means whatever you expect from the real classroom situation which is happening in the colleges and in the school, that everything can be happening in this particular learning management system, which is called as Moodle. It is also called, if I will pronounce it, the full form of this particular Moodle is Modular Object Oriented Dynamic Learning Experiences. So this is particular, application is quite useful and you can use it. Other things what you can do here also, you can give classes to the students, you can assign lesson to them, you can distribute particular assignments to them, and you can create quizzes for them, you can grade them. And one particular aspect let me discuss with you, what you can do is that suppose you have to go for online examinations. So many of the colleges are nowadays thinking about this one. So Moodle can be somehow helpful in this one, until unless the government decide that if they have to practice or not. You can create a question bank there. The possibility of creating question bank is there. You can create question bank on that particular paper, that particular subject, question bank will be there. And that question bank, what you can do is you can make it available online. And suppose for a particular paper, suppose the research methodology paper is there, different units, you make the several question paper, decide its difficulty level, then type of question, long answer, short answer, MCQ, whatever types of category, make a question bank, full-fledged question bank. You know, in the bank, how much more you deposit, you will be having maximum profit. So in the question bank, you also make lots of questions, every type of question you make it. You can assign the work to the different teachers, and you have to prepare the answer key also. That possibility is also there. The answer keys also can be prepared. It has got all this facility. I have experienced it. I know that these particular things are available there. You can mark for MCQ. You can give marks for long answer question. You can give marks for short answer question. You can also maintain maintain the privacy of the student also. Suppose a teacher is going to grade that particular student, he will not be able to know that which particular student copies this one. So that possibility is also there. So that also can be used. So Moodle has got full place. It is a full place platform where you can work and you can use it in this particular situation when we are not in connection with your students. Physically we are at distant places, but online the possibilities are there that you can use Moodle and you can run a full-fledged classroom and learning environment. You have to explore those things. You go and explore it and you will find that many things are there which you can experience. You can do it in fruitful manner using Moodle. Now what I will discuss, the third category, because I already discussed about two categories. One is organizing the resources, second one is learning management system. And the third one is, which I will be using, because many of you nowadays must be thinking about how to get connected with the students to becoming online. So what possibilities are there, what you can do? So there are different web conferencing apps are there nowadays. So many web conferencing apps are there. It has got several types of benefits, each upon the other. Some has got the maximum number of audience you can add. That particular aspect is somewhere it is 50, somewhere it is 100, somewhere it is more than 100, somewhere it is 250. So, and then again, it is, I'm talking about the free aspects. The paid aspects are also there. Once you pay it, the limitations are going off. You can get many facilities there. So that is there. So what you can do, what are the different platforms available there? There you can get different platforms. So the most popular one, let me discuss what are different platforms are there. Suppose GoToWebinar is there, WebEx is there, Cisco WebEx is there, then Zoom is there, then Google Meet is there, then GST is there, which is an open source. So in that you can say that there are several options available, but if you take my viewpoint, I will be discussing about two particular web conferencing app or meeting apps, which are quite popular nowadays, and you must be using it. You should try to use it. If you are not using, they are quite convenient to use, quite easy to use. They are open also to some extent. Google Meet, if you say that Google Meet has now become open to all, you can use it, but with some limitations, maybe there, because you are getting it free of cost, there are certain limitations. It has got limitations of 100 participants. Now it is now free for up to, I think it has been made free up to September. I don't know after September what will happen. So that is there. And then Zoom is also there. Zoom has also got the free option. It has got certain limitation, 45 minutes limitation, 100 participants you can add there. So these type of limitations are there. But practically the situation which basically we used to deal with the students, what we actually used to do, our class size are also around 100 only. Maximum of us has got class size of 100 only. And our class duration is also about 30 minutes, 45 minutes sometimes. Maybe in higher classes you have got 1 hour and other. So you can, if you are getting something in free, you have to also get certain adjustment we also have to do. So that adjustment we have to also do. So humko bhi karna padega, koi free mein hum log usko avail kar sakte hain open source ke roop mein. So what we can do is, now let me talk about Google Meet. Google Meet mein aap kaise kar sakte hain, kya kya options hai, kuch aap log ko pata hoga, kuch I will now like to say. Google Meet, you can, if you go to your Gmail account, in the left side where you get your inbox option, outbox option, spam folder option, there only you will get the option of hosting a meeting. So you click on that meeting option, you will go to the one screen where your camera will get on, and it will ask you permission that you allow the access to the camera, you allow access to the mic, and once you are giving access to the mic and the camera, then you can join a particular meeting, you can host a particular meeting, you can start a particular meeting. Once you start a particular meeting, then this is one of the ways, by Gmail account you can do. But if you have downloaded in your mobiles, then what you can do is in your mobile also the app is there. You can download it. It's a very small size, I think 16 MB or 9 MB, maybe that is the size of this Google Meet app application. To download it, there also you can click, and then they will ask you the access of your mic, and then for the first time it will ask you mic, camera, storage. That access if you give, then you can become live. And once you become live, then what you can do is that you can, because again, if you have started a meeting, someone should be there to in the audience to listen you. So what you can do is that you can share the link of in the first moment only when the meeting start, you get that option of share that link. That link you can get, and that copy that link, and then you can share that link to different groups, different WhatsApp group, different platforms, and they can come to the meeting and join with you. They also have to allow the mic, and then they also have to allow the storage to access Google Meet by Google Meet. Limitations they have to allow. So after that they can join. Now other things what you can do is that you can present the things also there. You can share your learning, whatever resources are there, that you can share with the students, to the audience. You can share. That option is there in the desktop mode. You will get it below the screen. You will get that option of presenting, and once you click on that present now option, what you can go do is that you can share your entire window. You can share that particular file, and they can see you whatever resources are there. In the mobile, what you can do, in the mobile also, in the topmost corner, if you get 2-3 dots are there, if you have experience, in that dot, if you click in the rightmost side, there you will get that present now option. So there also you can share your screen. Again, it will ask you to get your permission that you want to allow permission to Google Meet to share your screen. If you will allow it, then you can share your screen, and then again you can share your files. So that there you can do. Now, one more thing which has come up nowadays in Google Meet, that you can start the caption option. Caption option is also there. Suppose you are taking class and your mode of communication is English, then that caption is also available. Whatever you speak, it can come and it can be displayed on the screen so that the student can follow. Something, maybe audio problem, they are not able to listen to you. Then what they can do is they can simply follow the caption. So that has been also added in that particular Google Meet. You can control the meeting also. Other options are there, mute, unmute. That mic option is there. Your video also, you can mute. You can make it visible, or you can stop sharing your video. So that things you can do using Google Meet. And one more thing which I will talk about, that you can schedule your meeting also. Suppose you want to organize the meeting after 2 days, then you can go to Google Calendar. Go to Google Calendar, and you just what you can do, you just start an event there. You just create one event there. Once you create one event there, what you can do is, in that event list, you can, the option will get that you want a meeting also there, Google Meet option also there. So you just click that there, that one also. So what you can get is that you will get one link there, Google Meet link also you can get there. So that Google Meet link also you can share with the participants in advance. You can send them an email, you can send them through WhatsApp and other different social platform. So on that particular day, on which day you have organized that particular event, you can go to the Google Calendar. From there also you can click and you can directly come to hosting a meeting. And you can also come to that Google Meet app or Google Meet desktop application also. From there also you can host the meeting. You can see that it is already written there on that particular time, on that particular day. It will be visible on your Google Meet home screen. Already that meeting title will be there. So you can, from there also you can directly come. In Zoom also, these all facilities are there. Whatever I talk, you can schedule a meeting, you can organize a meeting, you can you can create this share screens also. You can share different whatever files you want to share with the students, with the audience, that you can share. And then you can also, suppose you want to make it a little bit protected, then you can create password also to say to join your meeting. So Zoom also you can explore and you can get these type of things. And if I don't want to discuss more on this one, because you must be exploring this one. My personal views goes that you Google, my personal experience says that for me Google Meet is quite Zoom is very much comfortable for me, because the way you can share the resources, the way you can communicate with the students, the way you can handle the class, you can manage the class and the data, how much it requires and other things, other facilities. And one limitation was there, that everyone was talking about that it is privacy option, and then security concern was there. That also they have tried to address, and now in the fifth version it has launched the encrypted version, and that concern has been also addressed now. So for my personal view, you can go and start using Zoom and see whatever technology you are using, the security concerns will be there. You have to be using whatever technology you use, you try to use your mind that you should be careful whenever you are sharing very personal information. Whatever personal information if you are sharing, then it will be harmful, maybe any type of app you use. So this is one particular thing which I wanted to share. Now I will like to share something about certain web tools we can say. There are different platforms which different persons are using. And these are many web tools are there, wikis are there, blogs are there, forums are there, podcasts are there, RSS feeds are there. But in these two are very much popular. Again, I have tried to make two most popular one, which I would like to share. Is first one is wikis. So wikis, you know the example of wikis. WikiHow is there. WikiKnow is there. Wikimedia is there. Wikipedia is there. So what are these? These are editable pages. Suppose you want to create a knowledge society and they are open sources. So what you can do is that you can, if you want to work in collaboration, then you go to Wikipedia and you want to start writing on a particular topic, and that particular topic others can also share. Others can also add to that particular topic. So wikis are one of the platform where you can work in collaboration with different peoples, and it is one of the tools which is very much popular nowadays. You can use that one, you can explore. And the other one, the most important, I feel this is the most important and popular one. I think wikis, maybe you are not using so much, you must be reading only Wikipedia and other things. But one thing which everyone is using nowadays is blogs. So what about blogs? So blogs are, it has been made of two words, web plus log. So from web, last P is there and log is there. So it is called as blog. So it is web logging. So where you keep the data in reverse chronological order, you want to keep the latest data. Suppose something you want to write, that will be in the topmost. Suppose in Facebook, if you are writing something, whatever you will write, it will come according to the time. Whatever someone has commented before you, then that will be in the top. So in that way it is there. But in the blogs, what will be there, whatever the latest comment will be there, that will be in the top. So the popular example is Twitter. Microblogging website Twitter is there. Everyone is using. You have got different news about Twitter. Someone has written something about particular issue, particular phenomenon. So everyone is talking about Twitter. But that is our social particular blog, you can say. But for educational purpose, if you are trying to use, then you must be knowing what is called blogger.com. Blogger.com, it is also hosted by Google. It is very popular. WordPress is also there. But Blogger is quite convenient. Everyone can use it. So what you can do is, in Blogger, if you go to your Google account, and then you just type blogger.com, and you can create your blog account there. So in that blog account, in whatever topic you want to write, suppose you want to discuss certain issues with your students. Suppose a topic you have already covered in your class, and then you want to discuss with your students, then what you can do is that you can write certain particular thing on the blog post. First of all, it will ask you to give your blogger name. You decide your blogger name. Once you decide your blogger name, whatever available blogger name will be there, you can choose that one. And then you can create your first blog post. You can write about that particular, suppose you have taught the students about experimental research, and then you start writing about experimental research on the screen. You write what are the different types of intervening variables, or what are the different types of variables which are affecting an experimental research. You give one open topic, and then let the answer come from the students. Let the answer come. And then you can add on to this particular comments, and then discussion can go on, and the students can share their views, their doubts, and you can also clarify them. So Blogger, you can use it very effectively, and there also you can share links. You can add links also. It is not there you just write the things. You can share links, you can attach images also, videos also, and that also can be followed. Suppose a particular topic you want to clarify the students, and then you just add a particular video to that particular blog entry, and then they can see that particular video, and then they can clarify their doubts. So Blogger is one of the aspects that you should be, and it is quite what you say in fashion also, everyone has got blogger accounts, and it is one of the way you can be very much visible to all, and you can share the resources with all. Suppose Wacklet I talk, suppose other different application, Google Classroom I talk. If you want to make it presentable, if you want to cover the whole audience, if you want that every person will know about that particular Wacklet page, you can embed that particular Wacklet page on your blogger account, so that you can do. And I suppose one YouTube video you have made, that also link you can share on your blogger account, and then you can give permission of editing, of commenting, that those settings you can decide whatever things you want to give access to the others. So that thing you can do. So coming to the last part of my presentation, I will try to discuss with certain open sources which are available, which can help you in creating two particular ways we can go. First one is for your professional development. Second one is for your e-content creation. So what are the different platforms available? Suppose you are talking about your professional development, then you must be knowing about massive open online courses or open educational resources. So open educational resources, as the name suggests, these are particular sources available online which you can which are copyright not is copyright free, and you can say that you should share that whatever whoever has created that particular document, and this is the most ethical approach that you should give credit to that particular person or that particular author. But they are copyright free, and you can say that it is, sometimes it is also called public domain, or sometimes it is also called copyleft. So in that particular domain, open educational resources are there. You can use it, you can edit it, you can share it. You are allowed to means you can, without giving contribution or without giving their name referencing, you can use it. But it is our ethical concern that you should contribute, that whatever things you are sharing, you should give credit to those persons also. So that is one ethical aspect. So what are the different platforms which are available? You must be knowing SlideShare. Everything, whichever educational topic you search, you will get something from SlideShare. So SlideShare is one of the resource where from you can get different type of materials. Then wikis are there, wiki commons are there. And then if you are talk about Indian platform, then you can see e-Pathshala is there, e-PG Pathshala is there, NROER is there, National Repository of Open Educational Resources. And then you can do different type of courses on SWAM for your professional development. So that you, those platforms you should try to use, and that will be very much beneficial to you. So that you can do. Those are open educational resources. Go and search whatever. Suppose you want, now you are a senior teacher and you want to learn about how to make animated PowerPoint presentation. So you may not be going and joining a particular class or particular course. You can go to these particular MOOC platforms and you can search how to make it effective PowerPoint presentation. You can enroll there. They are quite flexible also. The age norms, the time norms, means you can complete it in your suitable period of time. How much time you want to give, you just give in. All type of flexibilities are available there. So go to SWAM, go to MOOC, different platform. Other platforms are there. edX is there. Coursera is there. Then nowadays Canvas is also there. So in that platforms, in those platforms, you go and then you can enroll for different courses, take your time, learn different skills, and then you can deliver to the student. Teachers should be lifelong learners. Every time, if you find me some or one, two courses, I am every time doing on these MOOCs, every time I'm enrolled, because they have got given the flexibility. You can complete it with your ease of time. Whatever time you require, you take it, but you can, it is upon you how much time you can give and complete it. So that you can do. Then if you want to create e-contents, so there are different platforms. Suppose one concern, let me talk about, suppose you are making a PowerPoint presentation and you want a particular image, and just you Google on Google it, and then you get one image, you copy it and you paste on the PowerPoint. Do you think this is ethical? This is not at all ethical, because that image may be copyrighted, copyright protected. So if you, and sometimes it is written also there that you should, it is copyright protected image, and you just paste it and you just share with everyone, giving credit that this is my own work. So this type of practice is unethical. So what you can do is that you can go to different open platforms. Let me tell you certain open platforms, like Flickr is there, Pixabay is there, Creative Commons is there, then Pexels is there. Then other, you can say that one of the important one which is coming in my mind is that Render Forest you can do. There you can, it is quite what you say, paid also, but you can create so many e-content there. So many content you can prepare there, that e-content will be useful for while you are teaching your students, while you are dealing with your students. So this particular e-content particular website, I already told, speakers, Pixabay, and suppose you want to give certain sound effects, then you can go freesfx.com. Suppose you want to create one particular video where you want the sound of certain police vehicle, then you can get that particular sound from freesfxvideo.com or freesfx.co.uk websites. You can use that one. So these are the particular apps which you can use, or particular website from where you can get the things which are freely, which are having open license. Okay, they are not copyright protected. You can use them. So one more I would like to share. One is Moving Cube. You can note it down. Moving Cube is there. That Moving Cube, you can use it to create your own mobile app. Let me tell you. Suppose you want to organize a particular training program for 5 weeks or seven days, then what you can do is that you just install, you can go to that Moving Cube, you just create one app. It is, coding is not required. You just give your requirements, how many resource persons are there, how many participants are there, time duration, everything, you supply it, and it will create one app, and it will be given to you, and you can distribute among the audience, among the resource person, so that you can manage that particular training program. So movingcube.com, you can go and you can use that particular website to create mobile application. So that will be very much helpful to you. Then at last, something I will, last I'm just trying to discuss, which I have tried to prepare last one, because already time is up. That what are the useful tools for researchers, those who are going to, those who are researching, they must be knowing also, but still those who are not knowing, for them it will be beneficial. Like, first one is that suppose you want to assemble your work on the desktop, you write your first draft, you write your second draft, you write your third draft, but you keep in other folder somewhere, it is missed out, and many places you are searching, then what you can do, you can download, you can create one account in RAX, which is your personal assistant to research. And the second one is, you can also download Mendeley desktop. You must be knowing Mendeley, you must be knowing. So it is connected with Azalea's. So you can download that one, you can keep in your laptop, and what can be done in that Mendeley desktop, it is also free of cost. That also helps you to manage your work, written work, your thesis you are writing, or dissertation you are writing, or PhD work you are writing. That Mendeley will help you to create your citation, take care of your citation, for your reference, and everything, it will be managed using this one. You will get it as an extension in your Word, and it will manage your site and references, citation and references. So that can be one of the tool that you can use. Then EasyBib or BibMe is one, two applications are there, apps are also there, that apps can be used for creating references. You complete your dissertation, but once you come to the your bibliography part, once you are going to your reference part, once you are dealing with your creating your referencing and bibliography, you are stuck, because every time you go and write, you miss out something, some dot, certain comma, certain spelling, quotation or semicolons, and arrangement of the text, italics, volumes, many things you may miss out, because it is several references may be there. So what you can do, this BigMe or EasyBib can help you to arrange your referencing. It will, you just supply this referencing is for journal, then you can give the who is the author, where from you get it, and other things you supply, it will give you the reference. So this is, this particular platforms you can use. You can also be knowing about SPSS. All the researchers are knowing this particular SPSS, which is a paid software, but you can use the alternative PSPP, which is open platform, open software. It is created by GNU. We know that GNU is one community which is developing different types of open softwares. GNU, and it has only developed Moodle also. So Moodle is also open source. So PSPP also, it works. Many of the function of SPSS, you can do it on PSPP. It is free of cost. You can download it, install it, and use it just like SPSS. So that things you can do. So I think I have given in gist whatever different technology which is available with us, and this will be helpful to all of you, those who have attended my session. And I think I should be thankful to the organizers, those who have given me opportunity to participate, to collaborate with you, to give my knowledge, to share my knowledge with you. And I think in the future also we will be discussing on different other topics. If whatever platforms I discuss, whatever topics I discuss, if any of the topics, any of the apps, if you are facing certain problem, then you can contact me. You can get my email ID and password very easily from the organizers also, from Facebook link also, you can get it. So that is my final words with you. And now I'm going to finish this particular session. And I am very much thankful for all the audience, those who have participated, interacted, and listened to me. And I think I must have been capable of discussing a few of the important aspects, of the technological tools which will ease you your work in this particular time of crisis, and in the future also you can use it, that multimedia sharing platforms, Vacillative Explore, second one in learning management system, you go for Google Classroom, and if you want more technical one, then you go for Moodle. I'm not saying that it is very much technical, you can use it very convenient one, if it is dedicated learning management system, then you can go for creating an account in blog, then you can share the resources with the students. And one thing I like to, in the end, I would like to say that you should always try to give credit to your work, whatever you take from online or from offline, from any sources. If you take certain things, then you have to give credit to that particular person. You take permission from that particular person, then only you try to share those particular images or particular resources. So thank you, and I'm just now going to finish this particular session. Thank you all. Namaskar.